So, hello and welcome back. Now I'm actually have to introduce myself. So, hello, my name is Martin. I'm a senior consultant in T2Every. I'm also a Microsoft MVP. You can reach me on Twitter, Instagram, GitHub, at dasmuli. You can also find me on Stack Overflow, where I may have been answering questions about MS Build and also some NuGet-related issues. Today, I'd like to talk to you about source generators, which is a kind of not as new feature as some other features, but that have seen quite a lot of usage uptake over the last 2 years, So I'm very happy to give an in-depth exploration of them. So what I want to do with you, I'll give a short overview over the different techniques in metaprogramming that are popular in .NET. We'll also have a look at how source generators are now used in .NET 6. So if you're upgrading to .NET 6, you can right now take advantage of some new features in .NET 6. So even if you don't implement source generators on your own, these are things that you could use in your day-to-day projects. Then I'd also like to implement a source generator with you and walk you through the steps of doing that. Also, I'd like to give you an update on what has been changed in Visual Studio 2022, which gives you a bit of a new API for writing source generators. That actually make it work better in IDEs, and also give you a few tips on what to look for if you decide to publish your own source generator. So it is all about metaprogramming, which is, you know, a very helpful tool. You don't want to do the jobs that machines were created to do. So you don't want to end up typing a lot of code that is actually always the same. So it feels like bothersome writing this boilerplate code when you think, yeah, I could actually write code that does that for me. And I think one of the more popular terms for that is aspect-oriented programming, where you can add aspects to your program. Not necessarily something that source generation can completely cover, but things like logging, timing synchronization, deadlock detection are usually topics that other tools in metaprogramming deal with. But of course, there's always serialization, which is something that we do every day for API communication, for file format, reading and writing. And of course, we need to also work with some schema information. So we have had like XSDs for XML data, we have JSON schema and the OpenAPI specification, also called Swagger, for all of our REST APIs, with protobuf for very dense communication, or just CSV files for everyday data science work. So usually things that we don't really want to write a lot of code for. And in .NET, there are various tools that are used for metaprogramming. I think the most common one is actually Reflection, which is basically looking at the runtime that gives us information about the code that is running. Since .NET is a managed language, so it's, we don't ship it as a raw byte instructions most of the time, at least on the logic level, we can actually ask the runtime to give us information back about the structure of the code and how we could use that in our program. We can then emit intermediate language code. So we compile C# to intermediate language, and then the runtime converts it to the actual bytecode that runs on the machine. And the code can actually also give the runtime new intermediate language code that it will also run on the machine. Usually this is used in combination with Reflection to generate code. For example, if you've used XML serializer in the past for over the last 20 years, this will have done that to make the serialization code faster. And this is a bit more problematic in modern ahead of time compiled runtimes. So for IoT devices, but also for iOS devices where you can't ship IL compilers, which would have to rely on interpreting the code, which would actually make it slower. So this might be a bit more problematic. We also had custom build steps. So again, if you've used XML serializer and you went into the project properties, there was this checkbox, generate serialization assemblies, which is just a build step. It generates, it also uses Reflection to look at the assembly and then generates a DLL next to your DLL. This is the same that also ASP.NET Core precompiled views have worked before .NET 6, but also other tools usually hook into the build process in some form, either to generate C# code or to generate additional DLL files. But there is also intermediate language weaving tools, which after you compile your program, then look at the DLL file and actually change it. So this is actually one of the most powerful tools that are out there, but also one of the most complex. So maintaining this code is really, really cumbersome and really, really hard. This is why Fody also changed their licensing model to not respond to GitHub issues or requests, even just pull requests, because analyzing any bug or reviewing pull requests is just really hard and complex work, and you need to put a lot of effort in it. So they don't do everything for free. Even if they'd like to, it would just be too much to handle. Also, PostSharp is very, very good paid technologies. They also invested a lot of time, I think years, into extending the Visual Studio debugger, because if they change the DLL, then the debugger needs to know which line of your code actually correlates to the thing in the DLL. And this is also some work that really needs to go into these category of tools. But since C# 9, we have a new feature, a new possibility, which is called source generators. This is actually just what the name does. You can generate sources, so source code, and you can add C# source code, or even also Visual Basic, to the project. But it can do nothing more. So for example, if you want to rewrite existing methods or property implementations, you cannot do that using source generators. There are some ideas for language features that would enable that. But for the most part, if you need to do that, IL weaving is still the best option for that. So for example, implementing iNotify property changed, probably still better to use Fody. I will show you a different version using source generators later. But again, it depends on what you're looking for and what best fits your project. But source generators really work directly in the compiler. So it's basically a compiler plugin. You don't need to write MS build, glue code logic, which is all these XML in these proj files, which I find is a lot of fun, but most people disagree with me on that. And it works in a single compiler run. So no need to parse source code multiple times, which needed to be done before. So for example, before I used a project that would also implement a MS build custom step that also loaded a compiler, loaded all the source code, analyzed it, generated more source code, and passed it to the actual compiler invocation. So the code would have to be at least parsed and lexically analyzed two times, which is not very good. In this way, it works in a single compiler run. So the compiler starts to compile your source code. At some point, it stops, asks your plugin for any more files. It says, so here is my state. Please give me anything you want to add. And then resumes compilation. If you have multiple generators, all of them will see the same input, and all of them can contribute to the output. Unfortunately, you cannot really order these generators, because that would cause a lot of problem or interesting issues that need addressing, to put it that way. Of course, there are suggestions for that. If you have input, there is a lot of discussions on the Roslyn and the C# language repositories. And I really recommend looking into that, because it's a very active area that is being discussed. If you do want to tinker with it, there is a bit of recommended reading. So for example, the source generated cookbook really describes all of the features and how you can use them. It also shows you the project structure you should use. So if you create a new analyzer project, a new generator project, how to go about it and publish it. There's also samples, because I'm not that very deeply familiar with the Roslyn or the C# compiler APIs. So I always steal from samples and look into samples to make sure that I'm doing similar things than other people and not write code that is 500 times worse. There's also a nice list of existing source generators out there that just lists things you could use. So if you have a specific problem or you want to look for features that could improve your life, have a look at this list. And then Andre also created a list with actual examples showing you how to use these third-party or OSS source generators. But of course, it's not all just new. There's also features in .NET 6 that actually make use of source generators. So they've been out for a while, and in .NET 6, there's also built-in features that make use of it. And I want to show you some of them now. So let's switch over to Visual Studio. Here we are. So first of all, something we actually do a lot of in the web is JSON serialization. So at the heart of JSON serialization now is system text JSON, which is a kind of new implementation of JSON serialization that uses a lot of modern .NET and C# features to be most efficient. But of course, in serialization, usually you also need to do reflection, looking at what properties are there, how do I best write out the code, what data structures do I need to look at, and so on. So you would need to call deserialize on the JSON serializer. And the first time you would do that, it would have a look at what is an ILIST, what properties does person have. And in our case, we have three properties that we want to read. I've prepared a file in here with three people. And this would, of course, hopefully work. Perfect. But there is a new feature in .NET 6, is where you can actually prepare the information about which types you want to deal with ahead of time, is you can derive from a JSON serializer context and then use an attribute, JSON serializable, on this context to tell the compiler, hey, I want you to generate some code to be able to use in here. So if you go down here in dependencies analyzers, you see that there is a system text JSON source generation analyzer. And if we look in there, we see there is actually generated C# code, and we can actually look into that. So for example, we can see this context implementation, then for every type that is involved, we see that there is a generated file that corresponds to the type. For example, if I look into person, I can see there is a JSON type info of type person, and that contains a lot of information in here. If I scroll down here, I can see some property descriptions. So for example, it had a look during compilation, so it knows that there is a first name property, and then for property access, for actually invoking the getter and setter methods, they actually generated a static Lambda function to do that, which is a very fast way to do that instead of calling reflection to invoke a setter or a getter method. So this is very fast. It had a look at all the properties. And then for serialization, there's also a very fast serialization method in here. A handler method that takes a person and an UTF-8 JSON writer and then just does write start object, write string, write property name, serialize something else, and then write end object. So this is, again, created during compilation. And even these property names are also predefined in here. This is a JSON encoded text, which is also prepared to be able to serialize it very quickly. We can also customize this a bit. So for example, we could add more of these attributes to just generate more types. So if we had person and maybe also some other classes, we could just add more attributes in here. But we can also should be able to, better not show it here, but we can also specify, do I want to implement just the data model? So do I want to just pre-generate the reflection logic or also the serialization logic? So using these attributes, you can also do some customization on that. And the way to use it is you would no longer need to specify the type on deserialize. You could use context, fault, ILIST person. So, and the same goes for the serialized method as well, which then uses this JSON type info. Let's have a look if that actually compiles. And it seems that it compiles and it reads and writes. It reads this JSON file and then serializes it out again. And the idea would be if I have a large project, it would start up faster and it might be able to serialize fast as well. So it can actually increase the number of requests per second that I can serve. So another feature, since I mentioned earlier ASP.NET Core views, so these eraser pages that we have, CSHTML, can actually also be generated into my DLL. So previously we'd have our project name dot views.dll, which would contain the views or the pre-compiled views. And now I could now use the same feature to drill down into the analyzer structure, but maybe I'm not using Visual Studio, but Visual Studio Code, which allows me also to set in the project file this magic flag, emit compiler generated files. If I set it to true, it will output the files. I can also specify the location. So in here, I want to specify the compiler generated files output path. I'll set it to the base intermediate output path, which is this obj folder generated. And upon compilation, it will write all these generated files in here. So for example, if I want to have a look at how the view imports look, I can have a look here, or the view start. So this is all generated code from the CSHTML files. I think something very interesting is actually the layout. So you can see here, there's some write literal call with the HTML embedded into it. It writes all these different parts of the HTML file. And most of these values that are being written are actually pre-created so that also any transformation that needs to be done can be done as efficiently as possible. So no custom build step anymore. It works directly in the compiler itself. So, and then there is a third feature that I want to show you, which is actually regarding logging. So in modern .NET applications, we have these Microsoft extensions logging functionality, which gives us this iLogger and iLogger of T category interfaces. But of course, we would have to call actually logger.log. We have our lever. We can also specify event IDs and something and even more. But again, we would have to do the string parsing here every time to find the actual beginning and start, because we'd like to use named logging values so that we don't use 0 and 1, but we can actually derive structured information from that. So if you're logging to things like Azure, or I also use on-premises the Elk stack, so I'd like to search for log messages containing a first name property, which with specific values, then I have to use this logging syntax. But I could also now create a partial method. So as long as my class and my method are partial, then a source generator can actually implement the actual logging call. So if I specify this method here with two parameters, add this logger message attribute, that says, okay, this is the message, this is the level, and then call this, then the generated code should be Microsoft extensions logging generators, logger message, perfect. So you can see that there is a call prepared. It's called logger message.define with the type. So this does all the parsing and preparation with this message and a pass. Actually, if that message looks a bit different, so maybe if I want to write the last name before, and this generated message should actually create a wrapper struct, because it's not the parameters have a different order, so it creates an intermediate struct. In this case, a read-only struct that contains the fields and an overwritten to string method. With the format that I used, and so on. So it tries to generate the most efficient code. And of course, I wouldn't, for one message, I would not have written that code. Seriously, not. But of course, in this case, it also figures out that the iLogger is this field here. I don't have to do that. For example, I could also write a static class with a partial method in here that just takes an iLogger. In this case, this is an extension method that also takes some caller information parameters that the compiler knows how to fill due to these attributes. So for example, if I want to log method enters, I could just call logger log method enter, and it would write the trace message with entering this method in this file in this line number, also with an event ID and this trace message, and this would end up in here. So also things that make it a bit easier and also a bit faster to write reusable log messages. So quick summary. Sorry, we have this system text JSON generator. Again, look at which features you need and if the serialization features that you need support the different generation methods that you want to use. Typically, I could enable this for anything and it would just work. Of course, some benchmarks. So for the caching benchmark, which is very dependent upon serialization performance, there is a 40% increase, which is very much for that type of benchmark. Of course, you can use an ASP.NET Core as well. And also the HTTP client has an overload that we can just call, hey, get me, get from JSON async with a URL and just pass this context, and it will use this pre-generated serialization methods as well. Razor sort generators, which I showed you, can also be enabled and disabled in the project file. So if you find that you migrate a project to .NET 6 and something doesn't quite just add up with your Razor compilations, you can also opt out of that as well. And of course, there's the logging source generator, which has a few more options and ways to use it. So I'll just refer to the documentation for that. Okay, but let's have some more fun and write our own generator. So let's switch over to my demo. So what I want to do is I want to have a failed build. I'm not entirely sure why it's not correctly showing all of the error messages, but some things should not compile because this auto notify property does not yet exist. So we have a failed build, but I want to create a view model that implements all the properties specified by a specific interface. But I also want this partial class to have another implementation generated by a generator that actually implements these properties and also implements the iNotify property changed interface so that it gives me a property changed event to which I can actually register a handler to be notified when I change a property later on. So this is very useful for any MVVM application. And of course, code that I would not want to write myself. So this is probably the n+1 version of implementing iNotify property changed. And I'm going to do this using a source generator. And since, and for doing that, I created a project called the iNotify property changed source generator. This is just a .NET Standard 2.0 library because it needs to work both in Visual Studio, which is still a .NET framework application, and in the .NET SDK, which of course is a .NET Core or .NET 5 or 6 based application. So the minimum or the maximum version of that I can use that works across all these platforms is .NET Standard 2.0. But of course, I can still try to get all the latest C# versions by setting the lang version to latest. And the compiler just won't give me language features that rely onto any runtime implementation. And I would also use the Microsoft Code Analysis C# and Analysis features as a NuGet package, but tell it, hey, this is not a public dependency. I really only need this to compile, but not to run. And then the other thing in here is a bit of glue magic that allows it, if I created a NuGet package from that library, it would just allow it to be used correctly as is a source generator. And you can just find this using the link that I provided early to the source generator cookbook, which would show exactly where you need to put this. And the actual implementation of the source generator is just, I need to have a public class that implements iSourceGenerator, which has an initialize and an execute functions, and annotate it with a special attribute that tells here, I'm a generator that is active for C#. And how do I test this? So I could reference that from this other application, but I think the far easier way to test while developing is by writing unit tests. And the way I like to do this is using a library called verifyXUnit. And in this case, they also implement a extension called verifySourceGenerators, which gives me a way to just quickly compare if something changes in generated source code from a state that I expected. I can show you the verify step later. For now, there are some things that need to be put into a model initializer. This is from the verify documentation. But for testing a source generator, I actually want to create what's called a compilation, which tells, yeah, I want to have basically a C# project with some source code, which is representative of what I want to implement, and some flags. So do I want to use nullable reference types or not? Give it a references to a few assembly locations. And this would be my project. And then I can create my source generator, create a C# generator driver, which is the compiler component that runs code generators, and use it to run my generator, and then use verify to make sure that this run matches what I expect. And actually, I can also write a test that runs the generator and updates this compilation based on the source code that the generator created, and then emit an actual DLL file with the compiled code. So I can quickly run this to identify if I have any issues with the tests. So this should now fail. So how do I go about implementing this? So there are two stages in here. One is initialized, the other is execute. So initialize basically runs when the compiler starts running. I can do any initialization steps in here, and execute gives me the chance to look at the current state of the compilation and contribute source code to it. And the first thing that I want to enable is actually to be able to use this attribute here. So the easiest way to do that is just adding the attribute to the source code of the target project. So I can actually do that. This is the one thing I can also do in initialize. So I can do register for post initialization that I want to add a source, which just contains this sealed attribute. This is also annotated with a conditional attribute, which tells the compiler, hey, if you're not compiling in this specific configuration, so not debug, not release, but property change generator underscore debug, then just remove it from the output. So it will not mess up the DLL of the target project that uses the generator. Then I want to keep track of what I actually need to generate. And to do that, I prepared a class here implementation to generate. So I put in here for which type I want to generate something. The type here is I named type symbol. So this could contain the class person view model, for example, and then the list of interfaces that I need to implement. And in order to find these things, I can use what's called a syntax receiver. So a compilation is basically a tree of syntax nodes, and this uses the visitor pattern to visit all these nodes. And this visitor is then called a syntax receiver, and it gets a method callback called an array syntax node, and it can choose what to do with that. But I actually have to register this one. So I tell the generation context, hey, register the syntax receiver for syntax notifications. So what will happen is during compilation, the compiler will invoke this method a lot of times and then call the execute function and ask me, hey, do you want to generate source code based on the information that I've told you about earlier? So the one thing we have to do in here is we have to look at the things that actually interest us. So we actually have to look at syntax. For this, it's actually quite helpful to visualize how source code actually looks like. So I like to use Sharplab for that, which can do something like compile and decompile C sharp, but also give me an overview over the syntax tree that's used in here. So I can say this is a class declaration, which has an attribute list with an attribute in here with identifiers and so on. So you can see these things in here, which correspond to the classes that you see in here and the names and the properties. So we want to find out, are we interested in a class declaration? We return for anything else. And then we want to switch from just a syntax node, which is the syntactic model, to a semantic model, which also contains semantic information that tell us, okay, this is, if we just write an attribute name, this would just, the syntax would be, okay, here is an identifier with this name, but the semantic model can tell us much more. It can tell us about the namespaces, about properties, and so on. So it can really know, it knows what things actually resolve to. So we get the from the type symbol in this case, no longer syntax, but symbols. And from there, we can filter out, yeah, is this actually this attribute that we generated? Is it filled out correctly? And then we know which this. So, and then we get a tuple from the types that we are interested in and the interfaces that we need to implement for these types. So if you want to go into detail about that, I suggest setting a breakpoint and debugging to unit test from my sample code. So then we actually need some code that writes out the implementation. I've prepared that as well. So here is a function that takes this model object that we have, implementation to generate, also a flag that tells us if the target project is using nullable reference type, so that we can generate better code if possible. And then we can just use a string builder to append the things that we need. So for example, we usually want to start with auto-generated, nullable enables, declare the partial class. And then at some point, we would generate a backing field and a property. And of course, the setter also invokes this property changed method. So I can hook this up now in the execute method, where I basically get some more information about the compilation context, cast the syntax receiver of the context to the one that we implemented, and ask it, hey, which things did you find? And then for everything that it found, it calls generate implementation to get this string, and then adds this as a source code using source text from the string that we generated. So let's have a look if that test works. Yeah, of course, that does not, it doesn't compile yet, but at least the generator project and the test project compile and the test run. So the thing about verify is that it's not, it's a bit human dependent. It's actually specification by example based testing methodology. So for example, if I switch this getter here to a expression bodied member, which uses this error syntax, and I run this test again, the verify framework should tell me, hey, this is no longer what I expected. And says, okay, there is a difference now between what was generated and what I actually expected. And what I can do now, it copies me some code into the clipboard that I can run to accept this change. So I say, yeah, this is a deliberate change. This looks fine on inspection. Execute this move command. What happens now is that it actually changes some file that is hidden behind here, which contains these verified samples. So I commit that into a source control, and it will run the test and see if the outcome differs from the thing that is specified in here. So these are the things that are verified, and if the actual generated thing differs from that, So actually, did I really execute that? Let's see. Then the test should pass. Not sure why it doesn't show the update in here. Anyhow, we have a working generator now, at least according to tests. So I can actually add this as a project reference to our main application program. And then I need to switch out some magic in here. So I already prepared this. Ah, that explains why I didn't compile. So this is a project reference, and what I've added is an output item type analyze and reference output assembly false, which tells it, yeah, treat this as a compiler plugin. Okay, this means I've likely triggered a bug. Oh wow, that bug no longer exists. Perfect. It can reload the assembly after I compile it. So now this should compile. Thank you, Visual Studio team, for working on that. And I can see that my change handler is now executed after I've set this property, and I've never implemented one property getter or setter that also calls this change method. In Visual Studio 2022, which I'm already using, but there is another change in APIs. So source generators as a C# 9 feature also work in Visual Studio 2019. But there is a new API that is a bit different from the iSource generator API. It's called iIncremental Generator, and it aims to be a bit faster in most IDE-based environments. So if you do a type something, type a dot, it should try to run as little of generator code as needed, so that we don't have to iterate over all the syntax nodes every time. But only do a difference analysis. And this is the iIncremental generator. It then only uses one method, initialize. And the idea is this looks a bit like link. So we have information from the context, and we can use context compilation provider, do something like a select. And what we get back here is an incremental value provider. This is similar. You can think about it like an enumerable or a stream of values that just give me updates every time something changes. And what I can do then is call other providers, create a syntax provider, which contains here a static lambda function with basically the same code as before that I've used to look into, is this something that interests me and how do I process it? I still have my implementation to generate. The difference is I also implemented an equality comparer to be able to compare equality between different instances, and then use filter, something like where, use a combine function, which is also used from things like the React framework, use a select that does a projection, and then register source output, also based on these basically query-like syntax over these sources. So this looks a bit like link. It looks like a bit like a reactive stream setup, and it is just that. So this gives Visual Studio structural information about how my generator works, and it tries to do a comparison of what actually changed and which parts actually need to be executed. So if only one source file changes, then ideally this lambda method is only called for the syntax that is changed. And then at the end, my generator is called with still the updated implementation that was passed here, but only if the property actually changes. So if nothing changes in the syntax that concerns my generator, because maybe the implementation to generate is equal, then nothing should be executed. And the generation output from the last run is reused. So just some optimizations in here. But if you write a generator with that features, it will no longer run in Visual Studio 2019, just as a warning. So Just a quick overview over the things we can use. We can also process additional files. So we've just analyzed source code, but maybe we have something like a schema JSON file. And if we set a build action to C# analyze additional file, we can access this in code as well using context.additional files or additional files provided in the new syntax. You can also add metadata to that. So if you say, okay, these metadata items should be visible to the compiler, then the switch to C# analyze additional file should have created this additional file tag in my CSproj file. And then it can add this attribute, set it to, for example, a namespace that I want to generate into, and then read this from my generator. I can also do that for project properties, so can define which properties in the project will be visible to the compiler. And then I can set, for example, a default generation namespace in the project file itself. If you are fancy about that, you can also split this up and ship the upper part as part of a NuGet package. And then every target project can just set this property and it should just work. There are a few other things you have to look into for shipping things to production. So for example, I've mentioned C# 9, 10, now C# 11 will be out this year, which should be no surprise. Just make sure that when you generate code, it matches the language version of the project that is using the generator. Similar to that, nullability, so nullable reference types might be enabled or disabled. So you might get different compiler warning behaviors or different use expectations based on the project configuration. Of course, if something goes wrong, make sure you emit actionable diagnostics so that a error message also makes sense to the user. And I've also showed this auto-generated tag, which is very important, especially if you use these emit files to disk feature, where some static code analysis tools might say, okay, you have a code style issue because the style doesn't match our enterprise rules, but you can't change the generator all the time. So if you just put auto-generated in there, it will eliminate most of the user warnings. Again, look into configurability options, things like namespaces and so on. And also make sure if you target higher ROSIN APIs, that you just inform the users of which studio versions that they can use in or which .NET SDK versions this work in. So the .NET 6 SDK and Visual Studio 2022 support these new incremental generators. Older versions do not. And of course, if you want to pack it as a NuGet package or any other of these items, just have a look at these source generators cookbook. It contains most of the information that you will need. With that, I would like to thank you for attending this session, and I will be answering any outstanding questions in the chat. So thank you very much, and see you again at the top of the hour for the next session.